And getting back in here on Diamond Conversations, joining me here on a lovely Friday afternoon in, for me, beautiful Virginia. Sunny day, a little chilly, sunny day nonetheless. Spring training in full swing, as I am joined today by my guest, the author of a brand new book that we're going to talk all about today, Brian Wright, joining me. And Brian, you and I have a lot in common that we'll get into, but first of all, it's these New York Mets. How are you doing today?
I'm doing wonderful. How are you?
Oh, I'm doing fantastic. It's something that, you know, I tried not to make this podcast be about the Mets, but when I talk about baseball, it's only really one specialty that I could say I really have. It's talking about the history of this team. And we're going to get into your books today. We're going to get into all that. But I got to ask, it's the first question I think I've asked every Met-related person that comes on this show. What is it about this team that keeps us coming back for more every single year?
You know, I still search for that. You know, I seek out therapy sometimes for it. I don't know. I mean, as far as my connection to the Mets, it started with my dad, who has been a fan since the very beginning in 1962. And he passed it along, I guess you could say. And I've took it and ran with it. To really levels that probably he didn't expect. I kind of am a glutton for punishment. I guess we all are in a way.
Yeah.
Kind of still, you know, why do I, you know, some people even say I hate this team, but I love this team. I kind of feel that way sometimes, or just like, why do I keep watching? And I always get drawn back. And at this time of year, you know, late February, early March is the perfect time to be drawn back. And I guess the way last season ended would give you reason to be more overly optimistic, possibly heading into this year.
Yeah, the last couple of years have been a little bit better in terms of optimism going into the season, not necessarily looking at the basement, although we got pretty close a couple of years ago. But really, I guess you could say since about 2015 on, it's not like every spring is the doldrums, and it's not we're just waiting to get our butts beat and another losing season, another bad team. You know, by July, it's all the minor league guys, all the stars are hurt. We've kind of turned the corner, so to speak. But, you know, we're Met fans and we're resilient and we're durable and we kind of expect everything. So right now we're in a good part of the spring. We're still very happy.
Oh yeah. No, we're very optimistic. And I think, and you're right. The last few years going into every year has been pretty optimistic. It's just what's happened as the years have gone on, you know, into, as you said, like the summer months, is where you kind of, all the dreams die. Last year kind of ended a little later than probably we thought originally. Yeah, as you said, it's not like, you know, 2012 or 2013, where we're just like all our hopes were dashed before the season even began, and we were kind of looking years and years ahead. So I think the good news about this year, as opposed to years past, is the Mets have a lot of depth. I think like in 2017, 2018, they had a good kind of, you know, upper crust, so to speak. But if like one person fell, if they, you know, there was an inevitable injury or two or 100, it seemed like everything else crumbled. So I don't think that, you know, I say that, you know, knocking on wood. I don't think that's the case this year, because I think there's a lot of depth on this roster. I think 1 through 26 is pretty well. The Mets are pretty strong in that capacity.
But we held our breath this week so far. We had Brandon Nimmo with the cardiac issues. We had even Matt Adams. They even sent the same cardiac doctor to get checked out. And then JD with the shoulder. So we're just treading lightly through maybe some of the minor things just to get through it. Because I think the remarkable part about that last season is that they did stay unscathed from injuries. And they were able to keep that team intact outside. Basically, if you look at from when they went upward, so about August on, everybody was there outside of Dom. Dom was the only one who was out.
Yeah, no, Dominic Smith was gone. That was the one big injury. I mean, Jeff McNeil had that hamstring injury. I think he suffered in Atlanta. That was a tough blow for a little bit, but for the most part, he was around in the home stretch. If this team stays healthy, relatively healthy, it's a really good team and one that definitely can contend for the National League East. And as we saw at the end of the year last year, when they're kind of at their peak, you know, bullpen notwithstanding, they are certainly, you know, very, very tough to beat, very tough for any team to beat.
put that August run, those couple of games against the Nationals, put that up against anything that you could possibly have imagined going into the year. Even the games against the Dodgers, the big Rajay Davis double on the Saturday night last. I mean, just those moments. Look, and as Met fans, we look for the moments. We look for those guys. And we'll remember Rajay Davis for the rest of our lives as a Met because of that double. I'm sorry. That's just how we are as fans.
Yeah. We take the small victories. Team across the city can say, oh, they cling on to championships, and that's all they want. We kind of we take those September victories that kind of pull us a little bit closer in a wild card race. Kind of equate the team like to 1997, where they were they barely missed the playoffs, but they missed it by three or four games to the Marlins, and they had some good September victories. It was a fun team that didn't make the playoffs, and that was what the 2019 team was as well.
They could have their Lou Gehrig moments, their Babe Ruth, you know, whatever. We have James Loney hit the big home run in Philly for the clincher in the wild card game in 2016. So the little things that we look for as Met fans. But that's enough about current Mets. Let's talk all-time Mets. Let's talk your new book, the New York Mets All-Time All-Stars. Now, you have some other Met books under your umbrella, which is awesome, but we're going to talk about Mets All-Time All-Stars. So tell us how this book came about, the concept, and what led to this thing coming onto the paper.
Yeah, it came through my publisher reached out to me, or the Lions Press an editor came to me after my first book, my first solo book, Mets and Tens, was released in April 2018, and asked if I wanted to do this all-time team type book that they're doing. Lions Press is doing a series of this with other teams. The Yankees came out, the Packers have come out, and the Pittsburgh Pirates just came out concurrent with this Mets book. But I chose a 30-man roster, including also with a manager, two coaches, which are the two honorable mention managers, a general manager and an owner. I used a mix of in terms of the criteria for selecting the team, specifically with the players, I used a mixture of traditional stats and sabermetric stats, depending on if I wanted to highlight someone's defensive ability, I made sure to kind of use those modern day statistics that kind of highlight someone's ability on defense. Also, I had more criteria was included, like a combination of impact on the franchise, postseason and or big game performances, if they have any single season or career records. Longevity wasn't as much of a factor as much as being good or high impact for a prolonged period of time. And also I used a little creativity with how I structured certain positions and who I put there. For instance, like pitchers, there were many more great starting pitchers than great relievers. So I made sure to have I chose 10 pitchers, 7 of which are starting pitchers. I didn't want to just leave it to a 4 or 5 man rotation because I'd leave some really great pitchers out. But despite putting 7 in, I still left a lot of great pitchers out. I also made sure not to have a DH because that would raise a lot of questions. And also I put players because I was asked to organize this by position. I made sure to put someone or someone's candidacy, let's say, was based on where they played the most frequently. For instance, like Edgardo Alfonso, although he played at third base for a bit of his career, he mostly played at second base. Michael Conforto, although he's in right field, I judged him as a left fielder because he still played more games as of this moment. So the main thing I really discovered is that there are many different ways you can kind of use criteria to select a team. There's many different ways that you can, many different forms of criteria to select a team. And there are many different ways you can put them together and many different possibilities. So long story short, I think this is more a discussion point than a final say. It's more of a starting point of a debate than just me saying, this is the team. I think if everyone agreed with everyone I had on the team, it'd be a boring book.
Yeah. Hey, this is a topic for many a tavern across the New York tri-state area, and guys that you could sit there and argue that don't even need to look at stats that can give you lists of 15 guys for each position going back as far as the Mets do all the way back to 1962. But so looking at stats and stuff, did you keep it more based off of things that you were exploring versus things that you already knew about the individual players?
No, not really. I looked more in depth in terms of the players. I mean, I like I was talking about with defense, you know, I can't really tell you, you know, who, you know, how like Bud Harrelson's range factor is off the top of my head. So I really had to research that and to see how good it was relative to other players, not only in his era, but in terms of other players in Mets history, or a guy like Jerry Grody, you know, how often did he, you know, throw opposing runners out who tried to steal, and how much did he help as far as the pitching staff was concerned in terms of limiting runs. So not a lot of, I guess most stats were things that I had kind of either heard or read about before. But for the most part, they were stats, whether they were, you know, for a single season, a career, or for even a small period of time that was important to, you know, their impact. A lot of it was just researching and making and looking it up and seeing how it related and how it helped or hurt their candidacy. Let's put it that way.
Who was somebody that stood out to you as a player that maybe you didn't know was as good as they were in terms of the numbers?
So one player that I you know, when I originally started making up like a draft of who I thought would be on this team, you know, in terms of just right off the top of my head, hey, I think that could be I think they could be at that position. And I thought like, oh, well, they'll get replaced. The player that I was surprised actually made it was Daniel Murphy. And as we know,
one of the
polarizing kind of figures now in Mets history based on what happened in the years after he left the Mets. But Daniel Murphy, for all his terrible base running, he had some good base running moments. I guess he was just more perplexing, and also it was just his shaky fielding. Was a very consistent hitter. Got about, you know, 30, you know, averaged about 30 doubles a year when he was healthy. And then of course everyone remembers the tear he went on, the power surge he went on in 2015.
I'm still scratching my head about that.
it's still unbelievable. How did that happen?
Unbelievable, crazy. Every automatic. That's all you can say.
But that was the guy. Yeah, that was the guy that I didn't realize, you know, even though it was recent that he had finished off with the Mets, I didn't realize how pretty consistent he was in terms of a hitter.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah, he was great. And especially, I mean, he's fallen off a little bit the last couple of years. I know injuries have gotten to him. That first year he left for Washington, I mean, he was unbelievable. Oh, wow. But if you recall, people were saying that the first opening day that he had as a, you know, as a full blown member of the team, I mean, people were saying he's going to be a batting champion. He's going to be the next so and so. And you know, you had Francesa was taking calls, and people were praising Daniel Murphy. He was telling them that they were crazy. But really, at the end of the day, he ended up being a real consistent offensive output player for the Mets. And that's a great one to say. Now, how about somebody you didn't know about per se? So you followed Murphy, I'm sure, a lot closer than some of the older players. Is anybody from the older generation that you got to know a little bit more?
It's funny because I'm more like I've just like read or watched a lot of the older players in a sense more than the players that I followed kind of currently. There were more recently. So most of the older players, I kind of had a good sense of their background. I guess the guy that probably gets so overlooked that he probably deserves more attention is John Matlack, who was kind of like the third or at best the second fiddle to Seaver and or Kuzman in the Mets rotation, won the 1972 Rookie of the Year, was pretty good down the stretch in 1973, probably was their best pitcher actually through the postseason, and he actually made three starts in the World Series. But his record, he was kind of Jacob DeGrom, before Jacob DeGrom in the sense that he got no run support.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. And I think his record is either even or very close to. I'm trying to remember off the top of my head, but it's certainly in the book, the exact record. But he got he compares pretty favorably with Tom Seaver in some respects. You know, certainly not up to Seaver, but very good. And he just did not get a lot of support from the offense. I mean, none of the Mets pitchers did in the mid-70s, but him especially. And I think like 1974 was almost egregious. I mean, he had a great year, but had a losing record and a low ERA, but just got no offensive help.
Yeah, no, that's and it's a shame too because he did have a pretty long career afterwards. Did not go away just because he left the Mets didn't mean he was done. And it's a shame, yeah, that he did not get that support and somewhat forgotten. And I want to say the last couple of years, the Mets have done a much better job of kind of integrating the past and some of the names that maybe newer fans aren't very familiar with. And that's a big, it's a big thing to preserve the history of a franchise, you know, and
Yeah,
that
no, it
looks
is.
like this really helped it.
Yeah, no, it is. So, yeah, hopefully this book will just be a little look into the history of the team, but I'm really glad that the Mets are not only doing a few things to honor their history. I think everyone has seen like how Clover Park looks right now, as far as like the meshing of the eras with the players together, like Seaver and DeGrom holding the Cy Young. I think that's really cool. And I love that they're inducting three new members into the Mets Hall of Fame, John Matlack being one of them, Ron Darling and Edgar Alfonso being the other two. So I think it's a long time coming. And I'm glad they're doing
Some of those pictures are a little weird. I'll give them that. Some of them are
that.
nice. Some of them are a little odd. You know, they tried the Hernandez talking to Alonso. That's a little weird. You know, what would they both be doing at first base?
Yeah, why are they both standing there? I still honestly, when I first saw it, I really liked it. I was like, that's really cool. And then I thought, like, why would they both be standing there?
Why are they just hanging out? You know.
Yeah, and then I guess the Michael Conforto's head superimposed on Nolan Ryan's body was a little strange.
That's a little weird too. Yeah, there's some weird ones. It's a very great concept. I like that they're doing that, but very, very odd because, you know, for many years, the Mets had a great old timers day and they always brought old stars back and they just stopped doing that around the mid-90s. And it's such a loss. And even though they do the Hall of Fame still consistently, you scratch your head, you go, Ron Darling isn't in it already? You know, like Matlack wasn't in it already. I've been to a few of the inductions. And if they didn't tell you who was literally in the Hall of Fame, you would never have known before they built the museum at Citi Field.
Yeah, it's true. They like I think when at Shea Stadium you would never they
You
were
never would have
so
known unless you
evident
were
that
there. And they say, you know, I was at Mookie Wilson Day, I was at Gary Carter Day. Unless they say, hey, by the way, did you also know that all these other guys are in the Mets Hall of Fame? You would never have known back then.
Yeah, they could have gone through the list again they should go through the list every time they have a new induction.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, it's a very great concept for the book. I mean, I'm behind anything having to do with the Mets, and especially in the spring, it gets people ramped up. It gets you all jazzed for just about a month away from the start of the year. But before we get into our wrap up, and we'll give all the plugs again for your other Met book and this book, want to just ask you a couple Met related questions to yourself. Now, just looking at you, I'm not gonna judge by your years, but I'm gonna guess you fall into the Mike Piazza, David Wright category. So, who's your all-time favorite Met?
I have a few. Like I have like different. I mean, Tom Seaver is like my favorite, just general player performer. I think there are obvious reasons behind that. I started following the Mets. I started to become a Mets fan when I was like five or six, and the first thing that I watched was I feel like the first thing I watched was that highlight video of 1986, and my
Yeah,
dad
well, there
had
you
it.
go. Now we could be best friends for that because that's my deal. Yeah, absolutely.
I was born in 87, so I just
You
missed
missed it. You
86.
just missed it. Yeah, you just missed all of it.
So the first guy that I really gravitated to was Gary Carter, even
The
though he had
man.
just retired. I guess in 92 he retired,
Yes.
but I had only known him through that video in 1986. And so yeah, he became kind of my guy as far as tying that team together. Of course, as the years went on, started to really become enamored with Mike Piazza. Even before he was traded to the Mets, I just loved the way he swung the bat. And then he comes to the Mets, and I'm like, okay, well, I really like him. So yeah, Gary Carter and Mike Piazza became like my two favorites. And just for the sake of, for the sake of my last name, of course,
I
I
was
have
gonna
to.
say, I'm leaning. I think you might be leaning towards, you know, the namesake there.
Yeah, no, I always wished that a Wright would be playing for the Mets. I just thought it would be me, but certainly David Wright was. David Wright, I think we can allow him to be the best Wright that it's ever suited up for the Mets. So I always had felt like some kind of connection to him. And as far as current Mets, Jacob deGrom is really my favorite. I mean, I love Pete Alonso, and I just love that he has kind of taken that leadership role right away. And of course, when you hit 53 home runs, that helps as well. But
Yeah,
what I
nothing.
love about Jacob deGrom is that when all these great pitchers, these young pitchers were coming up in 2012, 13, 14, Wheeler, Harvey, Syndergaard, Mats, Rafael Montero. That didn't work out too well.
No.
No one talked about Jacob DeGrom. And he comes in, he's understated, he has no nickname, he's not called the Dark Knight. He's, you know, he just comes in and he wins Rookie of the Year. He's a key to the 2015 World Series run and now back-to-back Cy Young Awards. Not only is he the best of that entire hyped group, he is one of the best Mets pitchers to ever pitch. So I love that. I love that he was just understated and kind of didn't go with any real fanfare. And look at him now.
Unbelievable. Yeah, didn't come in with the fanfare except for that big hair that's now gone. He's gone corporate, so to speak. Yeah. They trimmed him up pretty quick, which is great. But yeah, I fall into the 86 category. Grew up watching the 86 tapes, the Let's Go Mets, the amazing era, all the year to remember. That was my A1. That was always going to be. It's still going to be 86 until it's. And I don't honestly, if they were to win this year, I would still be an 86 guy through and through. I mean, you just can't deny that team. The most. Say I've been to Shea Stadium a million times. I've only been to Citi Field a handful of times. The 86 reunion in 2006 was one of my favorite things I've ever been to, and I wish they did more stuff like that. But you know, now it's like, you know, Backman is completely X'd out. They're never gonna do anything with Lenny. Unfortunately, Gary Carter passed away. You know, we're starting to lose some guys, and it's a shame that, you know, I wish we could have bottled up that 2006 reunion and really, you know, kept that a little bit more closer to the heart.
I think that we saw that with the 1969 reunion last year, where you didn't have Seaver. Of course, a lot of the great Mets have passed away. They were just, you know, couldn't make it. So that was, as great as it was to see all those players, it was tough not having, you know, certain players, of course, like Seaver and Tug McGraw. So, you try to have these as frequently as you can. Obviously, they're doing on the anniversaries, but it's always great to preserve the history in any respect, whether it's those reunions or just these inductions into the team's Hall of Fame. Right. They're really great, and they kind of give the fans another taste of the team's history.
Now, are you a Shea guy or a Citi Field guy?
I went to Shea, I wouldn't say frequently. I mean, I lived out of state for most of my childhood. I would go up to Shea Stadium at least once a year with my parents. And I do miss it in some way. It's more just for the sake of nostalgia. But I love Citi Field, and I love that it has a nostalgic effect, and it's really grown on me in recent years. I'm glad that they, you know, moved the fences in and they have the blue walls as opposed to those black ones that were just way too far away. Yeah. So I love what they've done, and Citi Field is growing on me. And if in 30 years, I may be a Citi Field guy as opposed to a Shea Stadium guy. I think it just comes, your relationship with the stadium kind of evolves and develops over time.
Okay, this is a layup, though. All-time favorite moment that you've seen live. Let's go with that one. So a little curveball.
Oh, I've seen in person.
You've seen live.
Live. Well, the best Mets game is actually going to be three in a row. I live in Washington, D.C. And I know you just said you lived in Virginia.
Tip of the cap, Northern Virginia, represent.
Okay, yeah, that's where I grew up.
Nice.
So I live in Washington, D.C., and went to all three games against the Nationals in September of 2015 when the Nationals
were there for the Tuesday night game. That was unbelievable.
Oh, man, yeah. So I was, yeah, I got to see all, I had the tickets already bought for all three, went to all three, left happy for all three. So that was basically to lock up the National League East. That was the best I had seen the Mets in person. I'm hoping to add many more, a few more maybe this year, because I want to, you know, make sure I will try to make a point to go to more big games if I can. And, you know, next playoff game, I'm going to make sure to do that. So as far as, in person, that's my favorite. As far as having favorite Mets moment that I've seen, I think it's the Robin Ventura Grand Slam single game in 1999.
Classic. Can't beat that. Now, how about your favorite fringe? And this is the final one before we get into the plug and the wrap. Your favorite fringe Met player. Now, when I say that, I've asked this to a couple people. We're not talking your Piazzas, your Wrights, your Beltrans, your Carters, your Hernandez, your Straws, your Docs. I want the random. I want the guy that your Tyoshi Shinjos of the world. Mm-hmm. I want the guy that the Met fan is going to know and going to say, I'm down with that. Who's your favorite fringe Met?
I don't think, yeah. So I'm thinking right now, and I have one. I will say this is probably not a fringe guy. I love Curtis Granderson, and he's
he was great. Doesn't come to the top of the head though. That's a good one though, because he doesn't come right to the top of the head. That's a good one.
Yeah, and someone asked me in another podcast, who was a guy you wish you could have put on the team, on your all-time team, that was just never even put him like in the book, and that's the guy I would have. And if you were to make a book of great leadership and, you know, players that you would want your child to emulate, he's the guy. So I just love him just for the way he carries himself. But as far as like, I think this is a better fringe player that I really liked was Benny Agbayani, just because he was such an underdog.
Yeah.
And came, you know, Bobby Valentine knew him from playing in Japan and brought him to the team. And I think he was pretty much on the verge of getting cut in early 2000. He contributed to the 1999 playoff run. He was on the verge of getting cut, and then he hits that home run. It was either opening day or second game of the season. I think it was the second game. Hits that grand slam in Japan, and that kind of solidified him as far as being on the roster. I think Ricky Henderson was the odd man out. So, mm-hmm. And I had that home run in game three of the 2000 NLDS against the Giants, a 13-inning game. So he was, he was kind of my – I always – like. I love the underdogs. I love, in the sense of Jacob deGrom, he was kind of an underdog from the start. So I really enjoyed watching him come up, and I enjoyed watching like Benny Agbayani, because he was certainly that underdog that really came through in big moments.
We would have also accepted Rico Bronya and Joe Orsolek, because God knows I'll put them on my list any day of the week.
Yes.
All right. So as we get into the wrap up here, you know, I'll give you the floor. You just tell everybody where they can find the book, where they can find you on social media, and, you know, any other key events or dates you have coming up. The floor is yours.
Yeah. So if you want to buy the book, it's on Amazon, in Kindle or paperback. It's on all major online booksellers. That may even be at your local bookstore. I'm hopeful it is. If you're interested in a signed paperback, you can direct message me at my Twitter handle, which is at BrianWright86. I'm expecting to come up to New York for some events around opening day. Going to be on WCBS's Author Talks podcast. Also going to be at the New York Public Library by Grand Central Station on Tuesday the 24th at 6:00. Hopefully some other events that week as well. But anyone's interested in talking with me, or if anyone's read the book and they're want to debate something in a respectful manner, I'm all ears and happy to chat with you. So at BrianWright86 is where to find me.
There's nothing better than two Met fans getting together and having a good time, right? There's nothing better. Yes. You can go on any podcast you want. And if you are a Met fan, well, then you can fit into our little club. But there's nothing better than talking about a Met book with a Met author who's a Met fan and didn't just write it because he thought it was a good subject matter. I love that. And I really appreciate you coming on. If you want to follow the show on Twitter, of course, it's at Diamond Convo. If you want to follow me, it's at Chad EMB. This has been a great Diamond conversation. So you can now get back in the dugout. You can take off your jersey. You can kind of do whatever you got to do to get out of here. But Brian, I appreciate you coming on today and look forward to talking to you again in the future.
Yeah, sounds great. Thank you so much.